Welcome into episode 12, our final of the 2019 calendar year of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. I'm Daron Vaught. At the end of every calendar year, we at USA Baseball give out year-end awards, and we're putting out this episode just before the holidays, and we wanted to give you the gift of a few conversations with some of our award winners. But first, quick reminder, if you have not yet subscribed to the podcast, you can do so on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Play. We post every episode to the USA Baseball YouTube page. Hit us with a subscribe, and if you like what you hear, certainly give a sparkling review. Secondarily, go to usabaseballnews.com and register for updates if you have not done so. You'll be notified every time we release a new episode, as well as informed of any of the most recent happenings across USA Baseball. Let's run through the organizational awards for the 2019 year, beginning with who will be our first guest, the Dick Case Award, given to the Player of the Year across the organization, Robert Hassell of the 18U National Team. The Rod Dado Coach of the Year Award was given to Veronica Alvarez of the Women's National Team. Now, she's been a guest on this podcast before. She was the only woman in the coaching ranks. She was with the Oakland Athletics during spring training. So she was on our episode, I think, back in March. The Team of the Year went to that Women's National Team. And the Sportswoman of the Year, who will join us shortly, Alex Hugo, who had a phenomenal showing in their tournament, a gold medal performance over the summer. The International Performance of the Year Award, this will be our third of three guests, Alec Burleson of the Collegiate National Team in East Carolina University. He's a preseason All-American for the Pirates, obviously was on the CNT over the summer and hit a walk-off home run in game two of that five-game series against Japan. It was the first time he'd ever hit a walk-off in his life, and he's played a lot of baseball. The Service Provider of the Year, Zan Barksdale of the Collegiate National Team. The Developmental Coach of the Year, Troy Cameron from the 15U squad. The Volunteer Coach of the Year was Andy Pettit in the Prospect Development Pipeline League, the PDP. He, of course, was joined by a number of former pros, including Hall of Famer Chipper Jones and Scott Brosius, who is with us at USA Baseball as well. The Coach Educator of the Year, the final of our awards, Darren Finster from the Sport Development blog. That rounds out the 2019 Organizational Award winners for USA Baseball. So without further ado, let's get right to it with Robert Hassell of the 18U National Team. Colin, roll the open for me, please.
From high above Coleman Field at the USA Baseball National Training Complex in Cary, North Carolina, this is Covering the Bases with Daron Vaught.
Player of the Year for USA Baseball's 2019 editions of our awards here at the organization. And look, I mean, you've, especially over the past couple of years, you've pulled some hardware, we'll say. You've won a number of these Player of the Year types of awards. How does this compare to anything else that you've garnered over the past year or so?
It doesn't really compare to anything else, and it's because, I mean, I've always, you know, hoped and dreamed of getting to represent the country. So this one's always, you know, this one's going to be a bigger deal to me. And I actually didn't make the 14U, or I was 14. I didn't make the 15U USA team back then, and I didn't think I was going to get another opportunity to play. So it just means that much more to me to be able to A, make the team, and B, to be able to do what we did, and you know, whatever else comes after that. You know, the awards are great, you know, but the coaching staff and the players and the experience, you know, that you can't beat that. It's top notch.
Now, your baseball career in its early stages here has taken you many places, and especially within the United States, it's taken you many places. What was the trip to Korea like compared to any other kind of travel that you've done? Because, I mean, look, you're 18 years old and pretty well traveled for an 18-year-old, but that's still a little bit out of routine for you, right?
Yeah, and I've gone a lot of places in the country, but I've actually I had never been out of the country. So going to Taiwan and first and then Korea, it was cool in itself just to be able to get out of the country and see what it's like. But yeah, on the trip to Korea, I mean, it was cool. It was definitely different. The culture was different, but the baseball over there, it seemed like it was a real big deal. Those foreign teams, you know, that's what they do over Korea, Japan, China teams, Chinese Taipei, they were serious about their baseball. So it was cool to be able to, you know, play against those different competitions and see what they're like, see how they play. And, you know, it was cool. A lot of those teams were really versatile. They had, you know, up and down the order, their whole lineup was versatile. They could do everything, bunt, hit and run, everything. I mean, they were about it. So it was tough to beat them. Unfortunately, you know, we came up short to Chinese Taipei, but they were a great team. And, you know, just like I said, they were playing the game. They did their jobs. And so
would you, again, in that tournament were incredible. You hit .472 in nine games. You had 17 hits, a couple of home runs, drove in 14 as well. You slugged .806. What was it like to play against that type of competition? Because look, I think you're fairly accustomed to intermingling with prospects from the United States, but you talk about the culture difference in going to those other countries, and now you're playing against guys from other countries. How does that compare? Because again, you've played in a lot of all-star games and it's just kind of status quo to be playing against another United States prospect, but then it becomes a little bit more daunting when you're in Korea facing the Chinese Taipei or another country.
Right. So when I was 11 and 12, I don't know if you're familiar with the Little League World Series in Williamsport, Pennsylvania, but I went there when I was 11 and 12 and played in it. And so I got a little taste then of what, foreign teams were like, those international teams. But I mean, that was 6 years ago. So I mean, they're all, I mean, a lot of grown ups. They're actually older. They were a year older than us, every other team, because here, obviously, in the United States, after your senior year, you either go to college or pros or whatever you go to. Well, so they don't let guys play on the high school 18U team. So they're a little bit older than us. I think it was really cool. We all ate our meals together. Every team ate in the same room. And it was cool to talk to them and stuff. But the way to perform for us was mainly just to keep a brotherhood. I mean, we were together for, I don't know, since PvP. So that was months. So we developed a special friendship with each other, special brotherhood, and that helped us. We didn't really worry about anybody else. We were worried about getting the gold medal. It was cool. It was cool to chop it up with those guys and talk to them. And, you know, see, it was tough to communicate with some of those teams because they couldn't speak English and we couldn't speak their language. But it was, you know, like I said, it was a fun experience.
You mentioned the PDP. It's the MLB Prospect Development Pipeline. You get to play in it in its first season of existence or its first year of existence. What did you think of it?
It was great. It was great. It was a great step. Great thing to prepare us for. I really enjoyed it. I mean, it was baseball. I mean, if you like baseball every day, all day, you know, like I do, it's really a lot of fun. And those guys, I think, I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure one of the first days we were down there, Coach Leggett was talking about how over the course of the 3 weeks, there was going to be like over 1,000 years of professional experience, whether it be scouting, coaching, playing, stuff like that. So it was crazy to be around those guys. I got to hit with Chipper Jones, Lance Berkman, got to talk with Jeter and all those guys. So it was great. And Jules Johnson did a really good job of handling the scheduling and stuff for it. So it ran really smoothly. And it was a lot of fun. And to be able to get those many, 80 guys, 80 of the top players together in one place for that amount of time, I mean, everybody's going to benefit from it. Everybody's going to get better. And me personally, I got a lot better from just the PDP. So,
I want to go back and follow up on something that you had mentioned. You said it was the 14U or the 15U team that you did not make when you went through the trials?
It was the 15U team that went to Japan and they won the gold medal, but I was 14. So they were kind of older.
Yeah. So you were trying to play up. Did that put a chip on your shoulder the next time that you were around for one of the development programs and trying to make a national team the next time around?
100%. In that time, I knew that when I went to the trials when I was 14, I knew that when it was all said and done that I wasn't ready, that I hadn't been ready. And from then on, it's been a complete grind. And not necessarily to make the USA team, because I didn't think I was going to get another opportunity to play for them. It was just a grind just to make me a better player, make me a better person and all that. And it just so happened that I heard about the PDP thing and that I got invited to it. And, there was a chance to make the USA team coming out of all of it. So I was all in for it. And going down there, I definitely did have a little chip on my shoulder. I wanted to prove myself and perform, and I wanted to make the team. And, get that opportunity that everybody was talking about, how great it is to play for USA. And I got to experience that. So it definitely helped me going down there with a lot of confidence.
So you're a high school senior. I know we just discussed while not recording that you're taking exams for this spring season. It's your last at the high school level. What kind of goals do you have set for yourself as you've progressed over the past couple of years, especially, it just seems like, if it was there to accomplish, you've crushed it and knocked it out of the park, excuse the pun, in your final high school season, what are the goals that you're lining up for yourself?
Yeah. So it's funny, out of the 3 years I've been at my high school, we haven't won a state championship. So I have one goal this year, and that's to win a state championship for the school. Me personally, I have high expectations of myself. So I expect myself to perform at the highest level anyway. Personal goals and stuff, just to outdo last year, outdo my junior year. Just like my sophomore year, I wanted to outdo my freshman year. Junior year, I wanted to outdo my sophomore year. So just to outdo myself every single year, get better. Personally, but the main goal is to win the state championship.
I love it. The last thing to last thing to accomplish before you're out of there. That's cool. Aside from graduating, of course, right? I mean, off the field, how does that picture look? What you've got? You said you're finishing up exams now. You've got one more semester, and then you're graduated, right? I mean, I feel like, sure, especially with guys as serious of athletes as you are, sometimes we forget that there's the whole school thing and there's life going on.
Oh yeah, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. It's a lot. There's got to be a balance. Obviously, I'm focusing a lot on baseball, but the schoolwork's definitely important, and my parents stress that. I'm getting that done. I'm doing pretty good now, and next semester it should be a little bit easier. Some of my classes changed, so I think there will be easier classes next semester. I got lucky with that, so. That's going to probably hopefully go by smoothly, and so I can focus on baseball as much as possible.
I respect it, man. I know you're a Vanderbilt commit, so just to get in there, I have no doubts that you're going to crush school in the same or similar ways that you crush your baseball career. Well, Robert, best of luck with everything, with finishing up school, getting that state championship. We couldn't be prouder that you're our player of the year, and to have you represent us at USA Baseball on a fairly regular basis at this point.
Yes, sir. It was an honor to represent you guys. It was great. It was great. I appreciate it.
Congratulations again to Robert Hassell, this year's Dick Case Award winner, to the Sportswoman of the Year, Alex Hugo, in just a moment. But first, over the month of December, we counted down through the top 10 most popular items at usabaseballshop.com, and coming in at number one was the Youth Long Sleeve Legend Tee from Nike. It's a loose Nike dry fit shirt that features the USA Baseball star logo and comes in a variety of colors. So whether you prefer gray, red, navy, or royal blue, it's a classic addition to your USA Baseball gear. It was the most popular item in 2019, but there are still plenty in stock for a late holiday gift you can grab at usabaseballshop.com.
Alex Hugo, how does USA Baseball 2019 Sportswoman of the Year sound?
Sounds pretty good to me.
In all seriousness, though, what does it mean to you having just sort of hopped into this baseball life a couple of years ago to quickly progress and be of a level where you earn that kind of honor?
I mean, I'm very humbled to have received that award. I wasn't expecting anything crazy, but I think it's cool how accepting the team is of newcomers, and I think it was really awesome for me to kind of prove myself within the baseball world. We had a really great time, and I'm glad that we ended up winning it all down there.
So I do want to talk about your year-to-year improvement, because correct me if I'm wrong, 2018, the Women's World Cup was really the first organized baseball you had played after a long, successful softball career. You didn't quite get as much playing time, just the one hit in that tournament as well, and then you come out in 2019, and I mean, you torched the tournament. You hit 652 and four home runs. The U.S. Women's National Team, worth noting, won gold. You were the MVP. What was your off season like? I mean, what did you do during those months? Because I'm sure a lot of people who would like to improve their baseball playing ability are interested in that.
Yeah, I mean, the first year it was kind of like when I went to the tryout, that was my very first time playing baseball. So it was kind of nerve wracking, you know, and then it's of course a World Cup year, which was kind of like a whirlwind. So yeah, I mean, in the off season, I just, cause I work at a facility where we give hitting lessons, fielding lessons, all that stuff. So I'm very blessed in the sense I was able to hit every day. And kind of dedicate time to even just thinking about baseball, where some girls on the team, they don't have the luxury, you know, based on their jobs. So I just kind of had fun with it. You know, I wasn't putting too much pressure on myself. So I think that's how it kind of ended up happening in the tournament. I was able to just relax and have fun. So.
Well, talk about some of the similarities and differences, because at Georgia, you were a very good softball player. And I think at face value, maybe a more casual observer would think that it would be a more seamless transition from softball to baseball. But I mean, that's obviously not the case.
No, it's a little more awkward. I think when I first got there, it was weird just with the different dimensions of everything. I mean, you're used to seeing a ball come, I mean, 43 feet, but really by the time they deliver the ball, it's maybe 39 feet, who knows. So it was just, the timing was awkward to me. And I think it's a lot harder than people give credit to, you know. But I think it was fun, even though it was challenging. I think it made me a better athlete. It made me learn more about myself. So it was kind of fun, even though it was a little struggle in the beginning. Now it's, you know, opening up my skills a little bit.
What specifically did you learn about yourself?
I had to learn to be a little more patient, and control myself, you know, learn my swing differently, because I ended up actually changing how I was standing in the box and approaching the at bats, just because what I was doing in softball, it wasn't just going to flow right into baseball. And it could be different for other people, but I personally had to take kind of a step back and just learn how to relax a little bit, let myself have fun, not be so stressed out about it.
How did you find out about USA Baseball, and what led you to the decision to begin playing baseball after, like I had mentioned, you had such a successful career as a softball player, but as we've talked about with other former players on this podcast, it's the opportunities are a little limited, I think, once you get past the NCAA level. Was that something that went into account?
Yeah, after college, I played professionally for a couple years, and then ended up kind of transitioning out of that. And then I had seen other former softball players that have played on the USA Baseball team, and I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. I had never really known how to get into it. So another former softball player from the league told me about it, and she's like, hey, you should just come out, try it out, whatever. So, and just showed up to the tryout, and that was history, I guess.
I'm always interested in the dynamic. We've had some members of the team on as a guest on this podcast, and you know, you're a former softball player, and that's not uncommon to the U.S. Women's National Team for baseball. Malaika Underwood is a former collegiate volleyball player and played for the U.S. Women's National Team. What's the dynamic of athletes like? And I mean, how does that make for the experience? I mean, right? I mean, to many of you, it's a newer thing. It's a newer element to your lives as athletes that you've come into, and not to mention you're coming together as a team in addition to trying to adapt to this game as an individual.
Right. I think that all of our different backgrounds really help us kind of bring something different to the table. So like I've learned a lot about girls that have played baseball their whole lives. Just because I obviously grew up playing softball and then other sports, and then like Malaika, who played volleyball collegiately, it's cool to see everyone's experience and, you know, how they go through different programs. And then it kind of brings us together, makes us more well-rounded, just because everyone's not so cookie cutter, I guess. I think it kind of plays a cool part in how we play.
Well, let's get specifically to winning gold at the Copabe Pan American Championships. That was in Aguascalientes, Mexico. You guys won over Venezuela in the gold medal game, 8-5 victory. I've mentioned your MVP performance. What else stands out about the experience, the tournament, besides maybe your specific play?
I thought it was really cool. I've never played a tournament out of the country, so that was kind of a cool experience. it was also awesome to see like how the team just relaxed and had fun, kind of what I mentioned earlier. But I mean, we were just like, where we were there on business, but at the same time having a great time winning and having success that way, learning from each other at the same time. You know, I thought it was cool, just because my first year I didn't really get to experience, you know, playing all the different countries and all that. So it was just kind of mind blowing to me that there's something else, you know, rather than just like playing in college or playing growing up, you're playing almost the same people. And then now it's like you're playing internationally, which was really fun for me. And I think for some of the younger girls too on the team, kind of learning from the older players and then kind of all coming together, it kind of all just clicked this year.
So prior to the Women's World Cup last year in 2018, had you ever competed in an international capacity, like in a way that you would be wearing USA across your chest?
No, never.
So what was that like for the first time? I mean, maybe the moment hits when you find out you make the team. Maybe it hits when you first put the jersey on. I mean, others have described it as pretty special moments, but it hits everybody differently. How did you take that in?
I think definitely even just attending the tryout and seeing how it works, and then obviously making the team, putting that jersey on, was, it's just very special to me because I feel like I'm a very patriotic person. And we've had military family members, and I take that very seriously. So I think that it was just, you know, such a blessing, and I'm just very, very thankful to get the opportunity to wear it. So I think it's just very special to me.
I mentioned initially that you were named USA Baseball's 2019 Sportswoman of the Year. I don't think I was breaking news with that. You were aware, best I know.
Yeah.
I think I might be breaking some news to you with these, but a couple of more awards on the USA Baseball end of year docket. The women's national team is the team of the year for 2019. And Veronica Alvarez is the first woman to be named the USA Baseball Rod Dedeaux Coach of the Year. I want to start with Veronica, who's been a guest on this show. And I think people by now know her as an emerging success story in the coaching community. She was on staff with the Oakland A's during spring training, a former member of the U.S. Women's National Team as a player as well. What was her impact like on this team over the stretch of the Pan American Championships?
She is one of the best coaches that I've played for. She has so much passion and energy, and I don't really think anyone can match it. She is just one of a kind, which is awesome. She's very, like I was saying, she's very passionate, but not just about the game, but about the team. So she cares more about the players than if we win or lose. Obviously she would love us to win every single game and smash everyone. But I just feel very lucky that I'm able to be coached under her, and she builds great relationships with her players for sure.
What do you remember about the first time you met her? Was it at the tryout, or maybe previously before that in the build up to the tryout?
She was the very first person that I saw and talked to at the tryout because she was the coach of the team that I was assigned to, and she handed me my shirt for the week. And so it was cool because she, you know, seemed very serious and intimidating, but she's not. She's just so much fun and so great to be around. So it was cool. It's kind of nice that it's come full circle for me just in my short little time. Like, that was the first person, and now she is coaching. She reaches out to everyone all the time, checking in. You know, she cares about your personal life. She cares about everything. So it's really awesome.
What I'm curious, just because having known Veronica and interviewed her and talked to her on various occasions in my capacity with USA Baseball, I can attest to, from afar, it can be intimidating, right? She's an intense yeah. personality, especially when you get her in the baseball specific vortex. What was the first moment at which you thought to yourself, oh, okay, that's not, you know, that's not her all the time, and she's actually very compassionate and is gonna be a really good person to person coach and a friend as well?
I think even probably the first time when she kind of really broke out of the shell that I was around, we were scrimmaging in the tournament, in the tryout. And, you know, it was just like, I think that someone hit a double or whatever, and she's just freaking out, you know, sending people home. And it's like, you think, well, it's just a scrimmage game, but she takes every little thing, like, it's just so intense to her. And it's fun. She makes it fun. And like in the dugout, she's goofing off with people. She's giving people her coffee that she makes, and she's trying to get everyone hyped up, you know, to get on her level. But I don't really know if anyone will ever be on that level, but we try to get close.
Going to the second of those two awards that I mentioned, the women's national team is the 2019 USA Baseball Team of the Year. That's primarily because of the gold medal at the Copabe Women's Pan American Championships, and your performance had a lot to do with that. I mentioned that I love the U.S. Women's National Team and that we have it as part of our organization, as Team of the Year is announced, and you know that you were a part of that, what does it mean to you to sort of be part of that leading line of women in a sport that, you know, here at USA Baseball, we're trying really hard to embrace the future as women can play baseball and enjoy the game of baseball. But it's been a game that's, you know, at times, just like other things, has locked women out in certain cases. Does it mean, does it matter a lot to you to be part of a grander movement in that sense?
Yeah, I mean, I feel very proud to be a part of that. And I'm very proud of the team for their performance. But I think it's always about something bigger. You know, I know that the baseball world for girls is small, but there is a world there. And I think that we're in a very good position to be good examples for them and get them excited about it. You know, like, it's okay if you want to play baseball. It's okay if you really want to do anything. So I think that we have a stage that we're able to let them see, you know, that they're able to compete at our level or compete at whatever level that they're striving for, and that we can also help them kind of achieve that, you know.
What's next for you? I mean, obviously you've adopted baseball into your life. It's a big piece of it now. You're still relatively young. I mean, is the plan to continue playing for X, Y, or Z number of years?
Yeah, you know, kind of just because it is such a small window of the year when whatever we're doing, either whether it's a cup or Pan Ams, whatever. I mean, yeah, I'm committed to playing however long my body will let me, because I really enjoy it. And I think it's, like I was saying, it's something special, and I think we can do some good with it.
Well, we're happy to have you as part of the USA Baseball family, including your, I think, new-ish role as a USA Baseball shop ambassador. And yeah. I know you just did a photo shoot for all of that, and, you know, USA Baseball's social accounts are pushing those out. What's it like to see your face everywhere? I assume you follow USA Baseball on everything.
Yes, of course. Yeah, I mean, it was really cool when they brought that to me, and I want to help out any way I can. You know, I really want to support and push USA Baseball so people know about it. But that was my first photo shoot, and so it was the first time playing baseball, first photo shoot. They got me doing a bunch of stuff, so I think it's really cool. And they've got some awesome gear, so, you know.
What would be your favorite piece of gear? Do you have one?
I can't remember. I think it's the U.S. Federation hoodie, the Navy one.
Okay. Yep. It's the U, yeah, and the S and the comfy star in the middle.
Yep.
Yep. I know I've been back and forth on it a couple of times. I'm astounded by your performance in the Pan American Championships. I mentioned 600 plus batting average, 4 home runs. Was that stretch for you the most locked in you've ever been? I mean, you had some impressive runs as a softball player at Georgia. I don't know if in the zone is something that is a concept in sports that you subscribe to, but that's got to be as close to in the zone as you've ever been. Does anything else compare?
The only thing I would say is one of my best years that I hit in college, that was kind of the most fun I was having and the most loose I was, and where I wasn't trying to do much. I was just kind of letting it happen. And that's how I felt, in the tournament. So it was nice, you know, kind of reminiscent of that feeling again, and also just enjoying the games and the sport that we were able to play together. So I guess that's, what I would compare it to.
From my minor role here at USA Baseball, a sincere congratulations and a thank you for representing the organization well. Thanks for the time on the podcast today, and we'll catch up again soon, okay?
Yes, thank you so much, Daron.
Our congratulations again to Alex Hugo, the USA Baseball 2019 Sportswoman of the Year. Whether you're doing timely holiday shopping, planning ahead to another occasion, or running behind in your gift giving, give the gift of USA Baseball and allow others to find their favorite items themselves. Take the stress off and get them a gift card for a customized amount at usabaseballshop.com. Now to the USA Baseball 2019 winner for International Performance of the Year, Alec Burleson.
All right, Alec, first and foremost, I want to talk about your collegiate national team experience. I'm based in North Carolina. You play at ECU, so I've got some Pirates-oriented questions for you as well. But first, representing your country as a member of the collegiate national team is something that only you and a couple of your former teammates at East Carolina had ever done before, representing the Pirates in that capacity. So I guess it's the long way of saying you're only one of three ECU players to ever compete on the collegiate national team. You had a great spring. How did you find out about this opportunity that you were going to be invited to try out for the collegiate national team?
So I had been talking to my advisor a little bit, and he had mentioned it, but it wasn't really something I was thinking about. And then I took that information I got and went to Coach Goblin, because he had coached the USA team with Agnos and Packard on that team. And I went to him and just kind of asked him, and he said, I've heard some things, but and he got in contact with Eric Campbell, and I mean, through Coach Goblin's really how I found out I was going to go to the trials. But that's really how I found out. So,
was it something that maybe entering this season? I mean, you were a freshman All-American the year before. Is it something knowing that your coach at ECU, Cliff Godwin, had been on the staff the year before? Was it something that maybe like you had anticipated or had even thought was a possibility for your summer plans?
I mean, if I'm being honest, I didn't think about it at all. It wasn't, my freshman year, I didn't hit as well as I wanted to. I pitched more than I hit, and I pitched, better than I thought I was going to. But no, being a Team USA going to the trials or anything wasn't even in my mind. It wasn't something I thought that I could do for myself because of the way I hit my freshman year. But luckily I had a good season my sophomore year, and pitched well, hit well, and got the invite. But I mean, prior to that, it wasn't something I thought about or something that, I mean, it was obviously something would have been nice to achieve. Like I was trying to work towards that, but it wasn't in the front of my mind. It wasn't what I was working towards, but no, it was awesome that I did get the invite and the experience. So
seeing as how it was a bit of a surprise for you, what was your gut reaction when you got the question? Hey, I don't know if it was a call from Eric Campbell or he relayed it through Coach Godwin. What was your initial reaction? Hey, we want you to come try out for Team USA.
I mean, it was, I called my parents, told them it was awesome. I mean, knowing that Packard and Agnos, talking to them about their experience, they said it was an awesome experience. I mean, I knew I hadn't made the team yet, obviously, because you have to go through the trials and stuff. But no, it was, I was ecstatic. It was being able to have a chance to represent your country and wear USA across your chest was awesome for me. And like I said, just talking to Coach Godwin, Agnos, and Packard, and just hearing what they did and their experience and the relationships they built with the guys, I was excited to have the opportunity.
So knowing that you have, you know, strong relationships with Coach Godwin, in addition to Bryant Packard and Jake Agnos, your former teammates that you mentioned that competed with the collegiate national team the year before, what were your impressions of the national team experience based on what those guys had told you? Because obviously, I mean, I think if I'm guessing right, Coach Godwin's impression, what he tells you about the experience is probably going to be a little bit different than what Pack and Agnos were telling you, right?
They said overall, like the coaches being with different talent from across the country and seeing how different cultures play baseball was awesome for them. And I mean, I was just excited to be able to, like I said, have the opportunity to experience it, because at the time I didn't know I was going to be able to make the team. But no, they said, I felt like going into it, it was definitely going to be challenging, because they said there were some, heard them talk about some guys, and then you look in the draft and they were first rounders, and it was kind of, kind of nerve-wracking a little bit, but at the same time, I was excited, so it was awesome.
Well, so there's a couple of elements there, I would imagine, as a player. A, you're excited for the opportunity to compete for a spot on the roster. B, you get to play with some of the other best guys in the country, some of which you've probably competed with or against, and some of which you probably hadn't. And then, you know, there's the international travel aspect. Had you done much travel outside of the United States prior to that?
No, I had never been outside of the United States. Partially because my mom doesn't fly. She doesn't do planes. Okay. So we can never, or she doesn't do boats, cruises, any stuff like that. But, so we never really had the opportunity to, never really had the time to with, all the travel baseball in high school and all that stuff. But no, I was excited to, be able to have the chance to get outside the country and experience what there is outside of the United States. But, no, I've never been up until we went to Taiwan outside of the country.
Look, man, I get it because as a guy who was not nearly as good of a baseball player, but I played at the Division III level in college and played some travel ball in my younger years. But like you came up in Denver, North Carolina, and just as a state, North Carolina is a great area for that sort of thing. So in order to play competitive baseball, you didn't have to go that far.
Oh, no. I had never been on a flight more than close to 14 hours what the flight was to Japan or Taiwan, but that was a different experience. But the plane was fine. It was just the 14 hour ride that was kind of got to me a little bit, but
so in addition to the chance to travel, see some parts of the world you had never seen before, how would you describe the competition when you got to the team trials? Because look, you're at one of the best programs in the country as far as maybe a top, what, 20 programs in the country, by my estimation, at East Carolina. It's definitely one of the best programs in the country to have never made a College World Series. But you're competing with, you know, some of the best as far as guys who weren't going to get drafted during this summer and are all prospects to be high draft picks a year from that point and a little bit less than a year from now. Was it tense? I mean, did everybody kind of gel and mesh and sort of come together for one purpose? What was the ratio between camaraderie and competition?
I mean, during the trials, yeah, everybody's trying to win their spot. Everybody's trying to, earn their spot on the team. I mean, you had a lot of guys that knew each other, from like SEC schools and ACC schools playing each other on the weekends. I knew a couple guys on the team. So, I mean, at first you kind of had your little pockets of your SEC players, your ACC players. And then you had guys that played travel ball together that knew each other. But I mean, towards the end, we all came together. Obviously the Japan trip and stuff, we came together, but during the trials and, stuff, we all kind of meshed. I mean, we were together all day, every day at practice, BP games, stuff like that. So, I mean, we didn't really have a choice but to come together because we were around each other all the time. But, I mean, and there was definitely, some, I guess you could say people trying to hold back a little bit because they wanted to focus on making the team. But I mean, the competition obviously with Team USA during the trials was unbelievable. The talent that we had on that team was unbelievable. I mean, the first night we're all a little nervous, and then we get up there and we're facing Cole Wilcox throwing 98, 99 from Georgia, and you're just like, okay, this is awesome. It was awesome. I mean, all the arms were good, the hitters, and it was awesome at that point, I didn't know if I was going to make the team or not. I didn't feel like I had the best trials that I could have had hitting wise. But I mean, it was good to talk to those guys and kind of hear how they
go about their business in the box and all kinds of stuff like that. So, I mean, we all came together towards the trials, and when cuts were made, it was, some guys got cut that you didn't want to get cut, and you were like, well, damn, I wanted to be on the plane with them or whatever. But I mean, nobody really took it to heart. They were okay with it. And, so yeah.
I know you mentioned Cole Wilcox. That's probably a name that you knew relatively well, just being aware of the college baseball landscape before entering the trials. Was there anybody there that was not previously on your radar that you took away and you were like, man, that guy can play?
I mean, there were a couple guys like that, because I follow college baseball, but it's not something I know everybody on each team.
Sure. So, and you're wrapped up in your own stuff, trying to play and compete for the Pirates and you know, make postseason for your own purposes. So it's kind of tough to really, really keep up, I'm sure.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you're playing the same days they're playing, you're playing all the weekends they're playing, so you don't really get to watch them. But, I mean, Heston Kierstead from Arkansas, I didn't know the name, and I was like, okay, who is this kid? And watching him hit and stuff. But no, there were a few guys where I was like, okay, who is this guy? Never heard of him before. I mean, there were obviously some guys that I've heard of, not only from playing against them, but, I mean, obviously watching the College World Series and stuff and know a couple names from there. But, I mean, it was, and like I said, all the guys were cool. There were no, I mean, they were all easy to talk to. They were all fun to hang around. So it made the long days a little bit better. So,
you were faced with a little bit of a funny situation compared to the other guys on the roster, in that your East Carolina Pirates faced Louisville in the Super Regional and lost to the Cardinals. They eventually made it to the College World Series, but their coach, Dan McDonald, was the manager of the collegiate national team. Did you guys have any conversation about the Super Regional when you got to the team and both representing Team USA at all?
No, we didn't really talk about it much. I remember in Louisville after we lost and they won, wanted to go to Omaha. He shook my hand and said, looking forward to, coaching you this summer. So I think that was before I had got the, official invitation. So, I mean, but I mean, we didn't talk about it. They kind of blew us out of the water. There was nothing really to talk about, but, no, I mean, he was an awesome coach. So I like the way he knew the game very well, and he really focused on the little things within the game, because he knew we knew how to play baseball. We knew what we needed to do. Obviously we were there for a reason, but he tried to do his best to, help us with little things that maybe could excel our game to the next level. And it was awesome. He was awesome. So
something about Dan McDonald that I like a lot is that, especially with this collegiate national team, he put a lot of value in the idea of the two-way player in baseball. So you pitch and hit very well on both sides. And he took that into account with not just you in making this roster. Did it occur to you that, you know, but hey, this is a guy that I need to latch onto and seek for some advice, because, you know, he had a Brendan McKay win a Golden Spikes Award and a multiple time John Olerud Award winner. So maybe there's something from his time coaching McKay that I can glean from this to further my journey as a two-way baseball player and a finalist for the John Olerud Award yourself just as a sophomore this past year.
Yeah, I mean, I knew he had some two-way guys at Louisville, and I really just tried to take from him just the game of baseball, and I knew it would help both my pitching and hitting. I just tried to take away the little things he was talking about, the not the basic not the basic stuff that everybody knows, but the little savvy things about the game that he knew, that I could use and help excel my game a little bit. But I mean, he was awesome. He was more of a, his big thing was getting us together as a family. And like, we were not there for very long. We were only there for 3 full weeks, together as a team. But his big thing was to come together as soon as possible, as fast as possible, so that we could be the best team we could. I thought that was awesome, because that's something we really focus on at East Carolina, is just knowing one another, building those relationships. And that was a big focus, especially on the long travels and going somewhere you don't know, just being close to one another and helping each other out. And I think that really helped us play to our best ability and build those relationships that we'll have after Team USA that we still have. So
I want to ask one more thing on being a two-way player. And then, of course, we have to talk about the walk-off home run in Japan. How do you approach your role as both a hitter and a pitcher? I think maybe the more casual fan would be interested to know, you know, how much of thinking like a pitcher goes into your plate appearances versus a guy who's primarily a position player and a hitter? Or do you see it really as you approach them separately and you just do two things really well?
I mean, I definitely, I kind of do both. Like you said, I separate them, but I also use both of them to my advantage. So I separate them in the fact that when a bat's over, it's over. I don't think about it if I'm pitching that game, or if I have a bad inning, it's over. I don't think about it in the box, but also at the same time, I'm in the box. I try to think like a pitcher when I'm in the box. I don't think like a hitter. And then when I'm on the mound, I'm thinking like a hitter, not thinking like a pitcher. Unlike a pitcher who would be thinking like a pitcher, I try to think backwards a little bit. And I feel like that helps me be able to know what a pitcher is going to throw me or what a hitter's thinking I'm about to throw. And I can kind of work off that. But, I mean, it's something that I have to keep separate. It's kind of hard to explain. You keep it separate and make sure that one doesn't affect the other negatively, but at the same time, you use them to your advantage to give you that extra edge over the hitter in the box or the pitcher on the mound. So it's definitely a lot to think about. I didn't do a good job of it my freshman year, but I feel like I definitely made a step in the right direction last year and being able to use both to my advantage. So,
all right. So the walk-off home run versus Japan in your time with the collegiate national team, it's been named International Performance of the Year as part of our awards here at USA Baseball. Talk me through it, because I believe it was game three that you hit this home run. And correct me if I'm wrong, you told us, as in the staff at USA Baseball at the time, that you had never hit a walk-off home run. Is that right?
Yeah, unless I was 6 years old and hit one, I don't remember hitting a walk-off home run, no. And it was actually, I hit my first walk-off ever was in the Cape right before I came up for the trial. So I hadn't hit a walk-off before the summer.
So that was just maybe an RBI single that walked it off when you were playing in the Cape. And you had never walked a game off. That amazes me at any level.
Yep. Nope. Never.
How close had you come before? I mean, were there ever close calls where you put one maybe to the warning track and thought you got all of it, or?
No. Normally when I, before I got into college, I would get really nervous in a walk-off situation or where I had the opportunity to walk it off, and just get nervous and roll a ground ball to the second baseman or something, get really antsy. But there was never a time where I thought I was going to do it or anything. So
what goes into that, sort of changing your mindset in those situations? Because if you used to get nervous, is it just continually being in that situation that eventually works it out? Or is there something mentally that you've just been able to get past a hurdle?
I mean, in that situation in Japan, it was just, it was a tie game. I knew that I had some good guys behind me hitting, and I knew if I just got on base, that would be good, good enough for them to either drive me in or we could bump me over or something, get a pinch runner or something. So I was really just trying to get on base and try to get something going. Cause we hadn't, I think it was game two. And we hadn't really hit the ball well, hadn't really scored that many runs. But I was just really just trying to get on base and really any way possible. There was a walk, hit by pitch, single. And then obviously it turned out better for me and hit a home run. So, but no, there's nothing mentally really. I mean, obviously I try to calm myself down. It wasn't as nerve wracking, without runners on base. I feel like if there was runners on base, it definitely would have been a little bit more nerve wracking. But, I mean, I was just trying to, like I said, lead off the inning, get on base any way possible. And, but it wasn't as nerve-wracking as it could have been in the situation. So,
and you're right. It was game two. I think I had said game three, but that's the sort of thing that, you know, when you hit it, did you know it was out, and what went through your mind?
So it was a 2-0 fastball, and every time I look at the video, the ball almost hit me. It was way inside. I don't even know how I hit it, but, no, it went up, and I knew it had the distance to leave. I just didn't know if it was going to stay fair or not. It kind of hooked a little bit, and I was like, oh, that's definitely going foul. But I was rounding first, and if I'm being honest, I thought about this question before I even called you, and I don't even remember seeing the ball land. I don't remember rounding the bases. I don't remember anything. I don't remember all the guys at the mound. I don't remember anything. I mean, the video that I keep watching or that I've watched before, that kind of helps me realize what I was doing. But I really didn't know. I don't know what I was thinking in the moment. I don't know what was going on. Obviously, it was good thoughts. It wasn't anything bad, but. No, I can't remember the situation. I can't remember seeing the pitch come. I can't remember. I just can't at all. I blacked out, honestly. Once I hit first base, it just kind of blacked out. So, but
when you got to home plate, who was the first to meet you there? Any idea?
I mean, all the guys were out there. I mean, I don't remember. The only thing I do remember from that was stepping on somebody's foot. I mean, that's really all I remember. I don't remember anybody's, I don't remember any faces. I don't remember anything. I just remember getting bombarded, hit on the helmet, slapped, all kinds of stuff. Trying to get my jersey ripped off. It was an awesome experience. Like I said, I don't remember seeing anything.
No, so. that's appropriate, right? I honestly wouldn't expect you to remember every last little detail for losing yourself in the moment there. Well, awesome. Thanks for sharing that. I got a couple more things, because I want to ask you specifically about your time at East Carolina. And you're a North Carolina native, so the program, which you were probably aware of the baseball program at ECU a little bit more than someone else in the country would be. But it's gotten a lot of respect, especially in recent years. I mentioned you're one of three guys to represent in the past two summers for the Pirates on the collegiate national team. For those listening from another part of the country that maybe haven't really experienced, how would you describe the jungle at Clark LeClair Stadium? Because I think it's one of the best fan groups in all of college baseball.
Yeah, it's something else. I mean,
Coach Godwin asked if I can play left field all the time. And last year when Packard was out, he would ask if I can play left field, if I'm comfortable in left field. And I'm like, yeah, that's right in front of the jungle. I talk to them all the time during the game. But no, we've had guys from other teams that play their left fielder. They don't want to come back. They don't want to hear what the jungle has to say. I mean, it's awesome. And that now that they can have alcohol in the stadium,
right? That plays to it.
That might be a different animal to deal with for the opposing team. But no, it's awesome. It gives us a better home field advantage than other teams with their home field. It's definitely a game changer when it comes to tight games or anything like that. So
now when you're in left field, what's being said from the jungle is obviously different than when the opposing team's left fielder is out there. What's the funniest thing that you've heard from there, maybe while you're in left field, or maybe you heard it indirectly that it was said to somebody else on an opposing team?
Probably they were talking to me. I would be playing left field last year, and they would just be talking about my hair. I can't remember specifically what they were talking about, but I had really long hair last year, and they would just get on me for it. I mean, it's not all positive things towards some of our players. They kind of mess with us. Not that it's not pleasant. They just kind of, I mean, if you have long hair, they're going to let you know you have long hair. If you did something, if you, like Packer did against Campbell, if he falls over the base at first base, just rounding first base, they'll let you know about it. but no, we know it's all out of, there's no hard feelings or anything. It's not, they're just enjoying the game and having fun just like we are.
So ECU fans, I know this for a fact because I've gotten to call some of your guys' games. ECU fans loved the hair. You grew it out. You kept it for the collegiate national team, but you did shave for Team USA because you had, you know, a beard at one point. It was the mutton chops for a stretch of the season. Is that premeditated? Like, are you planning on a certain look for the spring of 2020, or do you just kind of let it fly?
I plan on having the hair. The chops were for Mustache March.
Yep.
We do that every March for ALS. We try to raise money for ALS. I think we raised over $10,000 last year. And he kind of, Coach Godwin, was supposed to just be the mustache, but he kind of let me let me kind of do what I want. I haven't figured out what I'm going to do this year. From my parents talking to a couple of the fans, they want me to bring back the chops, but I don't know if I can do that. I need to figure out something new. But no, I mean, I plan on keeping the hair and the beard. I mean, it's not like I'm trying to, and it's just my look. It's not like I'm trying to be anybody different or anything while I'm on the field or anything. But I mean, we'll see come March what happens. What I decide to do, and we'll see about that. So,
cool. Well, Alec, congrats on the honor, International Performance of the Year, for your walk-off home run in Japan with the collegiate national team this past summer. I know you've got a big junior year ahead of you, big plans for the Pirates. I saw preseason rankings actually just minutes before we started recording this, and you guys were, you know, 30 or so, and by most accounts, and I expect, especially with what you guys have coming back, you're going to buck that. You guys are a top 25 team in my estimation. So best of luck in the spring. Enjoy your time at home in Denver, North Carolina for the holidays. And thanks again for the time.
Thank you for taking the time out and letting me talk to you a little bit. And it's been awesome. So thank you.
That's it. That does it for this edition and the final 2019 edition of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. My thanks to you who have been around for all 12 of our episodes as we do this month. It's been a lot of fun to get started. Thanks to our special guests that we've had all year long. My thanks to Brad Young, Media Relations Director for USA Baseball, as well as Colin Pelosi, the man behind the scenes that makes Covering the Bases happen. One last reminder, until the new year, if you haven't yet subscribed to the podcast, you can do so just about anywhere you consume the medium. Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, and every episode is also posted to the USA Baseball YouTube channel. I encourage you to subscribe, rate, review wherever that applies, and let us know what you think. For one last time in the year 2019, I'm Daron Vaught. Thanks for catching this episode of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. Happy holidays, and have a happy new year.